Welcome. This is the ATRAM webinar series. We are about to start in a few minutes.
Almost everyone has at least one relationship with one financial institution. Practically all businesses, regardless of industry, require financial services at some point in time, be it credit cards, bank and time deposits, loans, insurance, or investments. But financials go beyond these. It evolves through technology, and rapid innovation has given birth to a long-term trend called fintech or financial technology. Fintech is a powerful trend. Electronic payments are steadily growing with a lot of room to grow exponentially. On top of this, we also have the rise of cryptocurrency and other blockchain technologies. With the ATRAM Global Financials Feeder Fund, investors can participate in growth of companies around the world that are involved with providing financial services. The fund gives you access and diversification to global financial names that we normally do not have locally. The fund also invests in fintech, which a normal financials fund would not. Invest in the biggest global companies in the financial industry. Participate in the global recovery. Diversify your investment portfolio by investing in this fund. Invest in the ATRAM Global Financials Feeder Fund. For more information, visit www.atram.com.ph.
Welcome. This is the ATRAM webinar series. We are about to start in a few minutes.
Do you want to make your money work for you but find investment intimidating? Do you want to build towards a better future? With ATRAM Group's funds, you can invest according to your interests and values. Investing is now made easier and affordable. Step into your future self, invest to reach your goals and aspirations. Matching your risk appetite and investment horizon has never been this easy. Let us help you maximize your earning potential by writing the growth story of the Philippine economy and opening your doors to the international trends in the global markets. Let us prepare you for a better financial future. At ATRAM, we're making lives better through investing.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to another exciting episode of the ATRAM webinar series. I'm Jude Makatol, your host from the ATRAM Investments team, and I'm delighted to have you all here today. Recently, we've witnessed unprecedented changes in the financial sector, from the rise of digital currencies to the integration of artificial intelligence. The world of finance is evolving and at an exhilarating rate, but amidst these changes, one principle remains steadfast: the concept of higher interest for longer. What does this mean for you? It means embracing the long-term perspective when it comes to investing, and it's about understanding the significance of global investments and how they can shape our financial future. Today, we're not just going to explore investment strategies. We're going to delve into the heart of global financial markets, and we'll uncover the latest trends, examine the impact of AI, and shed light on the importance of global investing. Whether you're a seasoned investor ready to broaden your portfolio, or a newcomer excited to venture into new opportunities, we aim to support you in making well-informed decisions and tapping into the vast potential of the global investing. So let's embark on this journey together. So you may share your questions with us by clicking on the Q&A button located below your screen and get a chance to win limited ATRAM merch after the program. To stay informed of the latest and future events and receive important updates, kindly visit our official social media pages by scanning the QR code in your screen. And additionally, a replay of today's session will be available on ATRAM's YouTube channel, ATRAM Studio. You can also check our website at www.atram.com.ph for more comprehensive information on the market, finance, investments, and all of the funds that we provide. We will also have a quick survey after the webinar. So we hope that you will be able to share your thoughts and share your insights about our session today and how we can further improve our webinars. All right, With those out of the way, let me briefly introduce our speaker for today, Vice President and a Product Strategist within the Fundamental Equities Group at BlackRock, representing global thematic and core equity strategies, Brian Knowles. Based in Hong Kong, Brian is responsible for delivering solutions from across the fundamental equity platforms to clients in the region. Brian has a vast experience with over 15 years of experience in the financial services industry. And prior to joining BlackRock, he has covered global equity markets in New York, London, and Hong Kong at Morgan Stanley. He most recently headed their Asia product team, responsible for the marketing and distribution of global research. Prior to that, he was a senior member of the global equity sales team in Hong Kong, covering sovereign wealth funds, asset managers, and hedge funds across the Asia region. He also worked in an equity sales covering Morgan Stanley's private wealth management franchise in the US, Europe, and Asia. Brian has earned a BA in economics and a concentration in finance from Boston College. So without further ado, let's all give a warm virtual welcome to Brian. Hi, Brian. How are you doing?
Hey, Jude. Thanks very much. I got to think about shortening that bio, but I appreciate the introduction and always great to be here with you and the community at ATRAM and excited to talk about financials today.
Yeah, we are equally excited as well. So take it away, Brian.
So I guess there's a few things. I'm always excited when I see the introductory video talking about all the excitement and benefits around fintech. But, you know, the financial sector is obviously a lot more broad than that. And so today I want to give you an update on some of the latest trends that we're seeing here at BlackRock. You know, I'm happy to talk about BlackRock, but really across the financials landscape, especially how volatile the sector's been over the last couple of years. Now, for those that remember, it was a little over a year ago that we were talking about the possibility of another widespread banking crisis. And fortunately, that was largely avoided, and we didn't see that contagion that people were worried about moving beyond some of the problem areas that we saw with Silicon Valley Bank or Signature Bank. And so while financials finished 2023 sort of in the middle of the pack, if I look at, say, U.S. sectors, and with, you know, tech obviously having a strong leadership, you know, it's important to remember that financials actually was the best performing sector in the second half of last year. And those positive returns have continued into this year. So, you know, similar to previous presentations for those who've joined before, I just want to give a bit of backdrop on why you should be looking at or excited to be invested in financials to begin with, and why at BlackRock we still believe there is a really compelling opportunity here. So if we could flip to my next slide, there's a few key stats here to give you sort of a reminder of where the financial sector sits within broader global equities. And by broader global equities, I mean MSCI All Country World Index, or the ACWI Index, which has 900 stocks. It is the second largest GIC sector by market cap, and it's actually the largest by earnings, with about 25% of MSCI World earnings coming from financials. And that's expected. That's what's expected for this year. It also has a value component and growth component, and those are the two of the benefits that you're realizing when you invest in the financial sector. So if I was thinking about the value side, that's things like dividend yield, and which is encouraging and something that we see a lot of, especially coming out of Europe and US and even EM to a certain extent. And then on the growth side, you have this incredible tailwind of digitalization of finance through areas within fintech. If we flip one more slide, this is going to give us a neat little snapshot of what influences all these different sectors within financials. So for banks, you can see the benefits from, that group benefits from GDP growth, and that's probably no surprise. Or if you look at life insurers, they benefit from interest rate, they have higher interest rate sensitivity, and so typically when interest rates are going up, life insurers typically do well. And there's a certain areas that say neutral, and just because it says neutral, that actually doesn't mean it can't perform well. This is just giving you an idea of some of the macro indicators that can impact some of the underlying fundamentals. And the main point is that you're getting both cyclical and non-cyclical exposure from the industry. But more important, there are five, or actually narrowed down to four, key reasons to own the financial sector. And all of these, we believe, remain intact today. So if we go to the next slide. Actually, sorry, I'll get to this in a moment. This slide I just wanted to highlight because this is one that I added to the deck, and apologies, I've done this presentation a few times and I forgot that I added this in. But it's important because this is how at BlackRock our portfolio managers approaching investing in the sector. And I thought it'd be neat to include this time because, you know, his investment philosophy and how I think a lot of us should feel about investing in the financial sector is having it center around relative value with a catalyst. And that catalyst is going to drive a re-rating for the company or companies that you own within a portfolio. And if it doesn't have both, we don't think it's necessarily a good investment. And so there needs to be compelling valuation, either relative to its history or relative to the other names in the portfolio or within its sector. And it really needs to have that catalyst. And those re-rating catalysts, as you can see there listed on the right, could be things like strong earnings revisions, which can help drive share price. It could be capital payout through dividends and buybacks. It could be M&A, as well as a few of the others that you see on the screen here. If we flip to the next slide, we're often asked by our clients, why now, why this fund, why any fund within financials? And as you can see here, this is what we're addressing on the why now. So I mentioned before that there were five key reasons. And so for those who have joined previous presentations that I've given on financials, we had five key reasons. Now we've narrowed that down to four, and I'll explain why in a moment. But the four that we see as being really compelling today are relative valuation, you have dividends, emerging markets, and fintech. And the one that's missing from previous presentations is interest rate beneficiaries, as we believe that with inflation peaking, interest rates starting to come down, central banks moving away from those tightening cycles, this has become less of a driver, at least in the short term, for the sector overall. And so just to touch on that before digging into those four drivers, while higher interest rates have been a positive for banks, falling rates doesn't have to be a negative catalyst. So I don't want anyone thinking that, okay, if rates are coming down, banks are gonna underperform. And the reason being is that US banks actually outperformed the S&P 500 over a one-year period after the final rate hike in four of the last five tightening cycles. So four out of five, or more often, you see financials outperforming after the Fed has finished its tightening cycle. And you can see the group even outperforming as they cut interest rates. And that is largely due to where the starting point is from where they're cutting interest rates, why they're cutting interest rates, and what level that we'll see rates settle for, say, the U.S. two-year treasury or the U.S. 10-year. That's really important, and that can really drive performance, say, for the U.S. banking group. And so I don't want anyone to think that we're entering this rate cut cycle and therefore financials can't do well. That's simply not the case, and we think that this group can continue to do well, and there's a few other drivers that I'll highlight in a moment. So if you go to the next slide, to walk through each of these, the first I want to highlight is relative valuations. This is something we talk about and have talked about consistently over long periods of time. And that's because this sector has traded historically cheap versus its history and versus benchmark. And so even despite the strong performance I mentioned last year with the group outperforming in the second half and performing well in this year, it's still trading at one of the cheapest valuations versus the broader global market of about 30%. It's also trading, and you can see that on both the left and right-hand side versus other sectors. You know, energy has now taken over as becoming the cheapest, where it used to be financials. And now financials have moved to number two. But if you look at the chart on the right, you know, over a long period of time, financials, while valuation isn't as cheap as it was, say, a year ago or 2 years ago, it's incredibly cheap. And we think that is a compelling reason to continue to look at this. And that's giving you that value component that people should be thinking about when they're investing in the sector. The second one on the next slide is on dividend yields. And again, this is something that we talk about quite often and frequently when referring to this group, because, you know, the financial sector dividend yield is still far higher than what you're getting from the broader market. And you can see this, how it compares if you look from left to right. So MSCI ACWI giving you a dividend yield from like 2.5% to almost 3%. Now, if you move on to ACWI financials, it's ticking a bit higher. And then if you look at just the U.S. broadly, we're looking at 1.5 times. So now it's similar to what you're seeing for ACWI financials broadly, almost 3 times the dividend yield that you're getting for the broader market by looking at European financials. And for EM, it's 2 times. And then the most important part here is, and the question that often comes up is, are these dividends secure? And the answer is yes, we believe that they are. Not necessarily every single company, but the ones that we want to have investments in, we want those companies to have strong balance sheets that can pay out those distributions and maintain the high quality dividend yield. And as valuation improves, you can see that dividend yield compress, but right now, today, it's still very compelling. And the other part I should mention, especially as we think about the European banks, is that not only are you getting, and also the US banks and other parts of the financial sector, is that not only are you getting this attractive dividend yield, but you're also getting buybacks. And buybacks plus dividends is part of that total return story. And in case of some of the companies that sit within the European bank sector, that they have a dividend yield of 6%. And if you throw in buybacks on top of that, you're looking at a total return story from buybacks and dividends of over 10%. And that is really compelling and a reason to want to maintain some exposure to financials. Now, the third reason is emerging markets, and that's on the next slide. So financials and emerging markets, we talk about this frequently, and nothing has really changed with the story. If anything, we have greater conviction today than we say did yesterday, is that emerging markets still offer the fastest growth in underbanked areas. You know, one positive view EM, our positive view on EM has changed from being a bit more mild last year, and that was because of the rising rate environment and rates being at a high level, and therefore you had, that was putting some pressure on emerging markets broadly, but also within the banks, and also a stronger dollar can typically put emerging markets out of favor. But we, that view has changed a lot since then last year, and so we're quite constructive on emerging markets and especially financials. And if I had to dig into regional specifics, we see a lot of opportunities in Latin America, and that's where we've been spending, you know, a great deal of time and thinking about our investments. Areas where we're a bit less positive, we still think there's a lot of work to be done. You know, China would be one of those areas. Whereas, say, in India, we are more constructive as well. But you know, China, that's not to say that we won't think of China as an opportunity for investment. It is a market that has attractive dividend yields. They're just a few other macro overhangs that we're concerned about. And then the fourth driver, and want to spend some time here, is on fintech. And if we flip to the next slide. So this is a group that, I've mentioned this before, has enormous tailwinds behind it. So just highlighting a few here. The fintech sector, or actually the financial sector broadly, has a huge profit pool, and that we think is ripe for disruption. And that can be through new entrants coming to the market, or it could be through companies that are adapting to change. If we move over to the chart in the middle, that middle chart is showing the continued rise that we see in digital payments. That's been happening for some time, but there's still a huge part of that addressable market that has not been penetrated yet. And we still think that that move from moving from cash on hand to more digital, it continues to get underway. And then on the right-hand side, you're seeing this shift in consumer preferences, which has already been happening, and you're going to see that continues to skew toward things like mobile banking. And I really can't think of any bank today that doesn't have a digital offering. In some cases, some banks, some of these neobanks, only have a digital presence, which works for some consumers, but not for all. Some do like going to the branch and having that, so it's not to say that branches altogether will disappear. It's just that we're going to see those traditional business models morph into offering more and more digital services. And I'm sure people are familiar with this. You know, on my phone alone, I have at least 2-3 banking apps. If we add in crypto, it's probably a couple more. But that's a trend that we do not see shifting. You know, what has changed for the fintech sector over the last couple of years is that the higher rate environment took a lot of froth out of the group. And so there are a variety of different indices or ETFs that you can have a look at to see how fintech has performed broadly. And the issue is that some of these companies got taken out and thrown out with the baby with the bathwater. And part of that came from not only the Fed increasing interest rates in the tightest fashion or the quickest fashion seen over the last 40 years. But also you then had a mini banking crisis, as I mentioned at the top of my presentation, talking about Silicon Valley, Signature Bank, and a couple of others. And so it has taken some time for this group to recover, but it did shine a light on those companies that were already well-positioned, that have strong fundamentals and solid balance sheets. And one theme that did emerge, just like in the technology sector, is that companies that have undertaken cost control measures and shored up their balance sheets are the ones that are being rewarded. And so that is a trend that we think will continue to happen. If you are a company that is running on sound fundamentals, that has a strong management team and putting in place, you know, measures to control your costs and increase profitability, like, those are the companies that are going to do well. So we remain completely positive on this group, given its exposure to this long-term disruption and structural growth theme. And if we flip one more slide, there's a lot that's listed here, but I thought it'd be helpful because I don't think I've included the slide in the presentation before. But essentially, is what it's showing is all the areas where fintech is having an impact. And that can be, if we start from the top, on payments, just like I mentioned with digital rising versus cash, and new digital banking services, instead of seeing more branches opening for those traditional banks. You know, if we move to talking about digital banks, like internet brokerages are continue to open up, providing people ease to invest their money. And equity markets are different asset classes and really providing those alternative options that you maybe don't find at traditional brokers, at least not with to have that at your fingertips. Like, that's all changing. You know, insurance is an area which I think is completely ripe for disruption. We think is completely ripe for disruption. You know, there's new entrants moving into that space. So if you are already an incumbent in that space, you're probably looking at bringing in some new technology and AI in-house to increase some efficiency in your product offering. And finally, like, a pretty hot topic today, and, you know, had been after going through its own sort of crisis, is blockchain and crypto. There's still huge debate around who are the winners going to be, and equities around those companies that have exposure to crypto. You know, where is the best exposure to have? Is it those companies that are creating ETFs? Do I invest in those companies? Do I buy the ETF products? Do I, you know, buy those companies that are offering, present exchanges? So there's a lot, it's still so early in the crypto part and the blockchain part that companies are still figuring it out, but it's quite evident that there's some pretty compelling tailwinds behind it. We flip one more slide. Now, this is, I just want to touch on this one quickly. Just, it's another couple of charts that give you a nice visual on the growth we've seen and expect to see with electronic payments. So you can see this gives you estimates out to 2027. So there's a pretty compelling backdrop. And if you think that, you know, this chart looks nice and it's just a forecast, well, if we flip to the next slide, so keep that left chart in mind. Now, these are two charts that closely resemble the chart I showed before on the growth we're seeing in electronic payments. And what you're seeing here is the revenue growth for MasterCard and Visa, and going back, you know, over almost 20 years. And you can see on the chart is that it's a lower left to top right chart. And the chart on the left is MasterCard, and the chart on the right is Visa. And so these are two companies that have been around for many years. They have established brands. They have consumers that rely on their services every single day. The point of sale is almost not imminent. It takes microseconds for you to use your credit card or even now with your phone to, you know, tap and pay for something. They've built out the rails. And as we move farther away from cash and more into digital, to the poster child's and best positioned are Visa and MasterCard. And that's because of the chart I showed before, is that just that rise in digital payments picking up, or just and more and less cash is benefiting these companies directly. And those are the type of trends that we would want to find across the entire financial space. And if we flip one more slide just to maybe wrap it up on fintech, this captures some of the disruption taking place. So banks know that they have to move their business models away from the top section. So, you know, why banks are spending so much money on technology outsourcing. It's because they're facing competition from new entrants, and they have to fight other emerging headwinds that are facing their business. So how can they become more efficient? How can they stay up with the times? And what all this means is that there's a large opportunity for them to outsource to another partner with third parties, to meet and develop technology that's going to, and all that together is going to really require a sizable amount of capital and a huge amount of spend. And so you're seeing that on the bottom left chart. So that's the opportunity for investors, is that there's a huge addressable market right now. And you can see that third-party spend as that continues to grow, as these incumbents look on bringing on new partners and forming partnerships, or even an opportunity for new entrants to come in. There's a huge TAM for them to address, a total addressable market for them to address. Now, before going to Q&A, I just want to quickly touch on the outlook, which is a bit more of a qualitative than having any charts for you to think about. But you know, a lot of what I'm going to discuss refers to my earlier comments on why we think, you know, there's four key reasons why we think the financial sector is compelling. So if I think about the views in 2023 versus the views in 2024, there were a number of investors who thought last year, especially coming into 2023, so in December 2022, that recession in 2023 was a foregone conclusion. Now, our portfolio manager was not convinced of that. In fact, he was more constructive and was positioning the fund that way, because what he didn't see in speaking with a variety of companies and looking at the financial metrics, that there wasn't really signs that we were going to see a negative credit cycle play out, which would have been sort of a hostile environment for the financial sector. And instead, what we saw is that employment growth and employment in the U.S. held up much better than expected. In fact, it continued to grow. GDP growth was stronger than expected. The consumer was more resilient than expected. And so those are the type of discrepancies that you want to look for in the environment where there's such a strong consensus in one way, it almost makes you want to question it. And the best way to do that is really to speak with companies or read company transcripts to understand what's happening in the broader industry, because those companies, especially in the financial sector, you know, their end customer, no matter if it's enterprise or if it's the individuals like you and me, that's where you're going to see the information. And so following financial data, like, that's going to be reflected in the company's fundamentals first, and something to, excuse me, something that's important to follow. So for this year, the thing around rates that I mentioned in the beginning, so the rate story is going to get a lot of airtime, and our perspective on where the U.S. 10-year will be sort of come year end, and probably into 2025, is that we're not going to see the U.S. 10-year move below 4%. Not materially below, and if it does, maybe it sort of trends around 4%. And that the point there is, we think that even though interest rates will come down, if we're looking at, say, the 2-year or 10-year, that still means that interest rates are going to remain high, which still works well for the financial sector and for the banks. Now, for banks, it's important that rates are high. You know, even for fintech, while rates remained high, and that's what put pressure on fintech in 2022, it was the velocity of interest rates moving higher in 22 that really put pressure on the broader market and also on the fintech sector. And so what we do need to see is some confidence and stability emerging from the Fed. And so once we get that, when we get a clear picture, hopefully, of inflation is getting closer to target, they're going to look to cut interest rates. All signs are pointing to, like, that first rate cut could come in September. Now, that's an okay environment for fintech to also do well. Now, while some people have been talking about the U.S. consumer being a bit wobbly as of late, there's still no evidence that we're approaching this hostile credit environment. So the lower end consumer is facing some pressure. I see that reflected in some of the data. But there was just a recent financials conference where a number of CEOs of companies were just talking about their overall book, and they were suggesting that, you know what, what we're seeing is a normalization continue after the COVID period. And that normalization is always going to lead to things like net charge-offs or delinquencies. And so you'll see some of the data, and yes, it looks really bad, and it's certainly bad for a certain cohort of people. But from what we see now is that that is not seeing a broad ripple effect that would give any concern that the economy is in really dire straits. And that's important not just for financials, but also for the broader equity market. And talking about interest rate cuts, it would not be the first time that the Fed has cut interest rates with the market all-time highs and navigated and landed and had a soft landing. And so if growth continues to hold up, inflation comes down closer to target, and the Fed starts cutting rates. You know, this is a similar environment to what we saw in 1995, and that's where we did see a soft landing. And we all know how the rest of that transpired over the next few years. And what's pretty incredible is that over that period, we had crises like LTCM or the Asian banking crisis in 97, and the market still continued to proceed to move higher. Yes, there were periods of volatility, but on that longer term view, this is largely driven by tech, of course. This time we have this fintech sector, and I'd be really hard pressed to think that the fintech sector, should we see some sort of scenario like we saw in the late 90s, and I'm not saying we're going to see another dot-com period, because I would highlight that the earnings profiles and the profitability of these companies in the technology sector is far different than what we saw in the late 2000s. You know, these companies that are leading the S&P or leading the MSCI world that we hear about every single day that have market caps above $3 trillion, like they're, the profitability supports that. And that's the difference between today versus, say, 20 years ago. And so if that continues, and again, I don't know that your guess is as good as mine is how long this persists, but I think what we do know is that the growth backdrop remains favorable, interest rates are likely coming down, and typically that's a pretty good outcome for equities broadly, and we think that's going to be really really supportive for financials as well. So areas that we like within financials that I think are worth keeping in mind are market-related themes. And so having exposure to investment banks and brokers is one area. If you think about the IPO markets returning, they only just started reopening. They were frozen for, you know, roughly 2 to 3 years. On top of that, you have M&A starting to pick up. That's also positive for not only the companies that are doing the deal, but the banks that are appearing on, you know, the front page of organizing and orchestrating those deals. You also have the benefit from lower rates at the short end. So I was talking about the 10-year not coming down perhaps below 4%, but staying closer to around that 4%, the 2-year coming in low. So lower that, you know, should perhaps act as a tailwind. You know, wealth management stocks that have that exposure and offer things like brokerage services, you know, that's, I think, an attractive area to be want to have exposure to. You know, another area that we think looks set up quite well for this year is alternatives, and we read and hear about the alt space quite a bit, so having some exposure there. And then, of course, being long fintech. So value and cyclical areas of fintech will do quite well, but also we think that fintech software is quite well positioned to benefit on some of those tailwinds I talked about in the previous three slides. Now, finally, I think, just given my comments around the consumer, we think that consumer finance stocks look quite well, said quite well, some of the credit card plays or consumer finance names. And then just regionally, Europe still remains our most favored region in terms of preferred, to have a preferred exposure, given they have attractive valuations, sort of at around 7x earnings, that's compared to the US around 11x. This, you know, both are very cheap versus where MSCI Europe or MSCI US are trading. You know, if I think about Europe, the additional factors, they have still a very high cash savings rate for consumers. And so that's typically much higher than the US, which means that the European system still has a lot of cash and liquidity that should support the banking sector. You know, areas that we probably a little bit less constructive on would be, you know, Japan, which used to be cheap, is quite hot right now. I'm sure everyone is aware of where and how the Nikkei is traded or where the dollar yen is. But Japan also trades a bit more expensive from a financial standpoint, so a little less exposure to those financials in Japan. That's a similar story for Australia and even Canada. Our portfolio manager was meeting with some of the companies that, some of the banking companies in Canada recently, and just came away thinking that like valuations are still pretty expensive. And while they have come down, there's some cracks emerging within the economy, the way that their housing market's set up. You know, this has been a story for the last few years, but now they have some adjustable rate mortgages, which could pose a problem, like, unless they start aggressively cutting rates. So it's a market that we don't think is worth having exposure to right now. And, you know, Europe still has to be one of our favorites, just given the total payout story. And I talked about dividends and buybacks. And finally, just on emerging market banks, I had that the slide showing, you know, we still think there's a huge amount of structural growth there. But this is a group that's still very cheap. They're under-levered now after taking some measures to get their balance sheets in order. And if we do see a lower dollar as the Fed starts to ease its monetary policy, that could also be an added tailwind. So with that, hopefully that gives you a very broad and well-rounded perspective of how we're thinking about financials. You know, there's obviously a lot of intricacies within the sector, but I think having that top-down view, you know, looking for a relative value, having those catalysts as we at BlackRock think about investing in the sector sets us up quite well for the remainder of the year. Jude, with that, happy to open up for any Q&A.
Okay, thank you so much for that, Brian, for that very informative presentation. We truly appreciate your insight and the expertise that you've shared for today's webinar. Your contribution has certainly enhanced our grasp of the global investing. Just to get my significant insights from what you have shared with us, what really caught my attention was that despite the current market conditions, the financial sector remains relatively cheap and still is able to provide handsome dividends. And with the emergence of technology innovation and fintech, we can clearly see that investing in the financial sector is both good for value and growth plays. So thank you so much for that. So in a thriving economy, one sector stands out as a primary beneficiary, financials. What's fascinating is how this sector is evolving with technology. Digital payments, for instance, have become very universal, especially on platforms like Shopee or Lazada. And let's not forget the surge in cryptocurrency. If you're seeking broad exposure to financials for success in a thriving market economy, consider the ATRAM Global Financials Feeder Fund. This fund is invested in the BlackRock World Financials Fund, which not only covers the broad financial sector, but also delves into the financial technology and emerging markets and potentially real estate properties through rent earnings. Even though the financial sector thrives in the economy, its diverse industries offer significant diversification as well. Moreover, exposure to fintech and REITs further enriches the portfolio's diversification. The fintech trend is incredibly powerful, with electronic payments continuously expanding and considerable potential for exponential growth. By venturing into emerging markets such as the Philippines, the fund can tap into success stories of individuals who may not even possess bank accounts. Consider GCash and Maya. Not everyone has a bank account, but many without one are likely to have them. This fund is ideal for aggressive investors, someone comfortable with the possibility of a 20% loss in a year for a potential double-digit annual return, average over a long-term investment horizon of at least 7 years. It's tailored for those aiming to grow their wealth, whether for retirement, inheritance, or general wealth accumulation. As one of our more aggressive options, it's best suited for those with a long-term outlook. So before we dive into the Q&A segment, I'd like to share some exciting news from ATRAM in 2024. This year has been very exceptional for us, marked by several prestigious awards, recognizing our commitment to innovation and excellence in asset management. ATRAM was named the Asset Manager of the Year by Fund Selector Asia, underscoring our dedication to outstanding client outcomes and setting higher industry standards. We were also honored with Market Awards Philippines by the Asian Investor, Leading Asset Management Company Philippines 2024 by the International Business Magazine Awards, and Leading Asset and Wealth Manager in the Philippines 2024 by World Business Outlook Awards, reflecting our team's commitment to superior solutions. Our innovative approach receives accolades as well, such as Leading Innovative Asset Management Company Philippines 2024 and Most Innovative Fund Management Firm Philippines 2024 from the Global Brand Awards and Cosmopolitan The Daily Business Awards. These achievements also underscore our commitment to sustainable investing, highlighted by the Mandate of the Year from the ASSET AAA Sustainable Investing Awards 2024. We owe this success to our dedicated team who continuously push boundaries in the investment industry. We extend our heartfelt thanks to our clients and partners for their unwavering support. Rest assured, we are committed to excellence and innovation as we redefine asset and fund management. Thank you for being part of our success story. We will now open the floor for the Q&A session. Please feel free to send your questions in the chat box, and our speakers will be happy to address them. So we've already have some questions submitted, so let's start with them already. Brian, are you ready?
Sorry, yeah.
Yeah, I think so. So
yeah, I'm ready.
To get things started, first question we saw here from our audience, we've noticed some weakness in the financial markets lately. What has caused this weakness, and will this continue, and should we take advantage of this?
So specific to financials or space more like index level?
And I think this is more on the financials.
It's a good question. I think about month-to-date performance around the financial sector, I don't think that has been, you know, it's never going to be up in, you know, bottom left, top right, straight line. You know, ideally we want to be going bottom left to top right. So, you know, sort of here and going up here, and that's what you want to see on your chart when you look at it and when you look at your investment return. So there's always going to be a bit of volatility. I'd say, you know, more recently it's just the, you know, from a top-down perspective, the rotations that we've seen are more in favor of areas like technology and growth at the expense. Like, I mean, look no farther than what's happening at the very top of the S&P or MSCI world in terms of who are those leaders. So there's a lot of crowding right now happening within the equity market. And there's two schools of thought there, is that this crowding suggests that the market's overly concentrated and that's a poor outcome. And we're going to see a drawdown. That's the more pessimistic outcome, is that having this crowding and over concentration in the market is not a healthy development. Now, the other school of thought and other camp is a bit more optimistic, and that's where I sit, is that there's a reason why those companies are performing the way they are. And people could be saying, you could say that maybe people are crowding into those investments because they have concern, and given the profit, you know, the profitability and outlook for those companies, it's exceptional, and that's where I should be putting all my money. Well, that's also because there's a degree of, or a lack of confidence in the market as to what is the shape of the economy going to look like. And if I had to point to a catalyst, I guess, over the last week, is that on the U.S. job, or what's the date, a couple of weeks ago, on the job front, is that if you looked at non-farm payrolls, they came in above expectations, but the unemployment rate ticked higher. And so, you know, there people are thinking that, okay, well, if unemployment is moving higher, then the Fed is more likely to cut rates. Well, that should favor growth stocks. And so, you know, maybe I should rotate more into growth stocks. Now, just because the unemployment rate ticked slightly higher, that doesn't mean that we're heading for anything really more sinister. It's just that the unemployment rate can move around, you know, quite a bit. Although not even quite a bit, sometimes it just remains sort of around, you know, 3.8%, or it could be 4%. And that, I think, you know, people get concerned on a short-term basis and wait for further evidence it's not happening. But what we're seeing and hearing from at least the financial sector is that, you know, things still remain quite sound. As I was talking about, some of the supportive trends around the capital markets still being pretty healthy. More companies are coming to market and doing deals. We're still seeing further evidence of IPOs picking up. And so, you know, I think the short-term volatility, you know, could be almost the forest for the trees, and that everyone's focusing on the Magnificent Seven, or maybe the Magnificent Five now, or three, and losing sight of the fact that if, like, growth holds up in the U.S. and we see things like manufacturing continue to come back or hold in, that the consumer continues to spend, and while there could be some softening there, as long as they're not falling off a cliff, that's still a pretty good outcome for equities generally, and for the financial sector. And a couple of areas that I think, like, look quite attractive is the consumer finance space, where people are worried that if you're going to see a negative credit cycle for those companies, that if you see more delinquencies and charge-offs, well, that's a problem for those companies. Well, that's what's priced in right now. But if we get something that's a bit more benign and more optimistic, like those are companies that could do quite well. And so I wouldn't, you know, while there's been some volatility in the short term, I think it can be explained by those things that I mentioned. And I think that the outlook still looks much more positive than that.
Okay, thank you for so much. Well, for the follow-up question, I think you have already touched a bit in this. No? Considering the current market volatility, what specific strategies would you recommend for global investing in the short and long term?
So within the financial sector, I think, you know, talked about a number of reasons why having exposure to the banks looks attractive. Having exposure to companies that have exposure to capital markets or alternatives or fintech, like there are a lot of reasons why these things can work, and they're not necessarily going to work at the exact same time. You know, we need certain things to fall into place. You know, fintech has enormous tailwinds behind it. And I think that, you know, one of the main catalysts that could really get the group going again is seeing some easing in Fed monetary policy while the backdrop still remains quite benign and supportive. Now, there, fintech is not just giving you exposure to, you know, the financial sector. There's a huge amount of innovation that's happening there. And across some of those categories I listed, sorry, those all fit within financials, but there's, within all the subgroups, there's a number of shots on goal for new or incumbents be disrupted and new entrants to come to that market. So, you know, those are a few of the areas that I think look quite attractive within financials and away from, you know, the crowding and excitement we're seeing around technology. I think it's fine to have some exposure separately in those companies, but that's only gonna be one piece of the pie. And, you know, at some point in time, you know, those companies won't be growing at 30 or 50%, those growth rates will come down and the rest of the market will catch up. And the rest of the market is priced much cheaper. I think about the S&P 500, we sort of have the highest concentrated stocks trading around, call it 25 times earnings, if not higher. And the rest of the group, it's actually probably, sorry, it's around 30 times. And then the rest of the index is around sort of 17, 18 times, if not even a little bit cheaper than that. And so there's room for the broader market to pick up. And if we dissect that even further, going back to one of my charts in the beginning of just showing how cheap financials are to the rest of MSCI ACWI, it's one of the cheapest sectors out there. And so as that, I still think there's room for that to compress. It doesn't have to go to zero, but even moving from 30% to 25% or moving to 20%, now that is a really positive outcome. And so still, despite the strong performance we've seen, a lot more to go. It's just that on a relative basis, it just doesn't look like it's as strong because of elements of the tech sector that have done quite well, but there's still such a big opportunity here. And when you add on top of that, the total return story, it's quite compelling.
Yep, thank you so much for that. Both you and I are in agreement that if the Fed starts cutting rates, then it might really prompt another wave of optimism in the markets.
Yeah, let me add too, is that one thing, like if you think about how well the market has done, given where expectations were at the beginning of the year for rate cuts, people were talking about 6 or 7 rate cuts. Well, now those have been for this year, and those have been priced out. We're likely to get 1, maybe 2. And yet the equity market has done just fine, and financials have done just fine. And so all of that being priced out has actually not harmed the equity market as everyone feared it might. And I was looking at a sentiment survey the other day. It's updated regularly. It's run by CNN, and it's a fear and greed index. You know, the market is at all-time highs right now, and that index is actually in fear territory. And that's because parts of the broader market haven't been performing as well. And so the advanced decline ratio is coming down, or you're seeing correlations or concentration picking up, and that suggests it's created a fear element. And so that's peculiar to me, is that why you'd see fear at an all-time high. Typically, it's the other way when we're reaching a peak. I get why people could be fearful, like it could come down. You see, markets don't peak on fear. They peak on greed and euphoria. And so I think that is another supportive element for, you know, why the market can do well. And throwing on top of that, like financials, I think is a, you know, for all the reasons I outlined, is really primed to succeed as well.
Yeah, thank you so much for that. We have another question here. What innovations in tech do you think will have the most significant impact on financial services in the coming years?
Well, I guess there's we can wrap in a bit of a conversation around AI. So what we're hearing from companies is that it's still, I don't think this is a surprise to anyone, we're still in the very much in the early innings, but we're starting to see tangible use cases emerging. You know, there's others that we think we're at the tipping point in terms of having the ability to deploy things like AI on a widespread basis, especially in, say, the asset management industry. So, you know, at BlackRock, I can say that we are spending a lot of time, a lot of resources on increasing efficiency using things like AI. And so AI, maybe to start, this is something that's, you know, a useful thing to have to improve your efficiency, which frees up time, which allows you to do different things within the firm and different tasks that you have. And so adding that, I mean, that's just, I think, the tip of the iceberg, is just like that operating efficiency. And, you know, people are fearful that AI could displace jobs. Well, what's likely to happen is that if you don't know how to use AI, you're at risk of losing your job, because as AI becomes more fully ingrained with the day-to-day tasks, and that could be within financial services, it could be with a lot of industries, like, I think it's important to stay on top of these trends. And so, you know, for me, AI is very new to me. And so I'm just at the cusp of learning how to use AI, but I can see that this is the direction of travel that our firm is taking. And that's no different. I can give you some other examples of companies that are also embracing AI. And so these are things that are going to be key for, you know, data synthesis and pattern recognition. If we think about investments, improving, you know, productivity is going to be really important. You know, giving that productivity element to client servicing teams to give them more insight on the customers that they're dealing with, so that they can appropriately and efficiently serve them. Like, that's a win on both sides, because that way the person who's covering you knows how and what types of investments are best suited for you, and they can do that. Some of that already exists, but it's just making it more efficient, which is going to be incredibly important. You know, KKR was at a presentation recently, and they've established an AI innovation hub where they have about 200 professionals, including AI engineers, and they're really focused on increasing the investment process around due diligence and leveraging some AI capabilities for investment insights. Now, at BlackRock, if I think about our investment platform, we have a systematic, active investing platform for the equity market, where we have a series of different funds that has already been using AI for decades. Like, you know, AI and quant trading isn't really new, but now this is moving beyond just, you know, the element of trading to other areas of financial services. So, you know, that's pretty exciting. And, you know, another person I saw recently present was the CEO of Blackstone, Steve Schwarzman. He was just saying that, like, the AI adopters, these companies that are adopting AI, are going to be the winners. And I think he was talking about it broadly, but, like, financial services certainly fits that bucket. And so in his view, over the next, like, 5 to 10 years, we're going to see a new cycle that AI is going to really support. And, what, you know, things that they're doing, you know, very simple right now. They're doing, like, investment committee memo write-ups, or they're doing portfolio company analysis. Like, this is just scratching the surface, and there's so much more that we will be able to do as we fully understand and integrate it. And so I think it's quite exciting. Like, I don't think it's gonna move the dial for this year, but if you look at company transcripts, the amount of times that AI is being mentioned, or anytime CEO is on CNBC or Bloomberg or any other mainstream media interview, they're talking about AI, because it's the flavor du jour. But, like, you can see that people are spending the time and investment to get this right, because there's a huge amount of efficiency that can be extracted from it. And that eventually is going to translate to the bottom line.
Yeah, thank you so much for that, Brian. So essentially, AI is going to be the key innovation in the financial sector. So thank you so much for that. So you and I agree on that as well. For the next question, are there any other investment options besides stocks and bonds to consider for global diversification? Are you guys looking into that well back there in BlackRock?
We're kind of moving away from the financial sector. But yeah, of course. I mean, at BlackRock, we have an enormous platform. We have $10 trillion of assets that we are managing on behalf of our clients. And that's spread across a number of different asset classes. So it can be equities, it can be fixed income, it could be the alternatives. You know, the infrastructure space is something we're quite excited about. You know, you'd be familiar and read some of the headlines about the launch of ETFs in the crypto space. And so there's a number of ways that people can get exposure to different asset classes. So you know, I don't want to speak on behalf of any one individual. It's important to speak to your financial advisor to give you some greater insight because, you know, it should be your investment portfolio should be tailored to what's best for you and for what outcomes you desire on a 5, 10, 15 year basis so that you can plan adequately for your retirement. And so I don't want to give any sort of views on where I think you should be allocated because everyone has a different situation, a different financial situation. But it's important to consider all those. And I would say speak to a financial advisor who can really tailor a solution that best fits you.
Yep. Thank you so much for that, Brian. Next question here. How do we avoid risks when investing globally? Like some, for example, currency fluctuations. And I think the key theme for the second half of the 2024, like issues like political issues in some countries. How do we avoid the risks stemming from those factors?
Yeah, for an actively managed fund, which you could find, you know, similar to a financials fund that we've been talking about today, or financial strategy, those are risks that you have to navigate. So it requires a huge amount of rigor, and why trusting an active manager who can navigate through those cycles makes a ton of sense. So in the beginning of the presentation, I was talking about how important it is to have that relative value with the catalyst. Well, you know, the other important consideration, which also goes into our portfolio manager's thinking, is you know, the bottoms up is probably the most important, but having that macro overlay is equally as important. So knowing what the political environment is shaping up to be like in some of those countries. Some of this will come about unexpectedly, and so there is a risk of that happening at any given point in time, or having that currency exposure where it could negatively affect your performance. But I think the important thing is entrusting in a manager who has a long tenured background investing in that space for a period of time. So, you know, perfect example, no surprise, is our portfolio manager for our financial strategy, who has expertise of investing in the financial sector for almost 30 years. So he has seen numerous cycles. In 30 years, we have seen the savings and loan crisis in 94, the Asian banking crisis in 97. We've seen the dot-com period. We've seen GFC. We had the mini banking crisis last year. We had COVID. And so someone with that wealth of background to help you navigate through those different cycles is quite important. And picking up and understanding the trends and what's the macroeconomic outlook for all those various different countries. You know, I mentioned that there's some countries that we think are perhaps worth avoiding for the time being until valuations improve. But also because a region or country like Canada is facing some issues, say on the housing side. And so having that knowledge and kind of steering away from that and allocating money elsewhere is quite important. And I think, you know, if I think about just equities broadly, it's important to have a long-term view when you're selecting your investments. That trying to invest for the short term increases the likelihood of your chance of being whipsawed. And what I mean by that is trying to pick your entry point, trying to pick an exit point, and then enter and exit. It's extremely difficult to do, extremely time consuming. And even the best managers in the world can't do that effectively. And so it's, I think, investing your money and having a long-term outlook, because it's important to remember that for any downgrade cycle, there's the upgrade cycle that follows. For any recession, you have the economic recovery. So those periods, while they look difficult in the short term, as long as the companies that you own are fundamentally strong, have strong balance sheets, do have some structural tailwinds behind them, there's an opportunity for those companies to do well. And so that's an opportunity to be adding on that weakness, assuming that you think the outlook hasn't changed for those companies. And so that's something to keep in mind, not just for financials, but for, I think, your broader equity investments.
All right. Thank you so much for that. Next question here. What are some of the biggest challenges that you see for investors navigating the global financial landscape in the coming years?
Sorry, Drew, can you repeat that question?
what are some of the biggest challenges that you see for investors navigating in the global financial landscape in the coming years?
Yeah, well, I guess a few things on the radar, which are going to be concerning, at least in the short term, is what we're seeing on the geopolitical front around elections, also around just tensions between a number of countries around the world. So on the elections front, we obviously have a very important election coming up in the U.S., and so we'll see the outcome of that. That could have, I think, short-term implications for your investments. But again, like, that volatility might and probably will present pretty compelling opportunity. And so I find that with elections, it creates a lot of noise, given that those how election cycles typically work. Now, we're seeing the same in the UK. We're seeing the same in France. And these election periods create short-term volatility and often a lot of noise for global equities. And so if you have investments in those countries which are seeing that volatility, it can look pretty dire in the short term. It really depends on who is the, you know, who's eventually elected as the leader, what are their goals, what are their policy initiatives, do they actually have the support, say in the US, if you have a Democrat or Republican candidate, what's the shape of Congress? There's a lot of question marks that just create a lot of unease in the market. But if you go right back to the fundamentals, like, are the fundamentals of this company changing on the back of this? Like, probably not, unless there's something that they're going to, you know, there's a capital expenditure that's going to be going the direction of one of those companies, and that if it's a different leadership, maybe that disappears. But if you have a company that's growing irrespective of that, that has strong fundamentals, strong balance sheet, and there's, you know, a supportive economy, like, that's what's more important than whoever is leading the country, in my view, at least on a longer term basis. So that volatility will happen, but in the long run, if you look at sort of 1, 2, even 3 years, that can prove to be a blip in your in the investment time horizon. And so that'd be one. Yeah, tensions around, you know, the world globally, what that potentially means. You know, it's driving things like reshoring, and so you're seeing a lot of, like, investment onshore in, say, the U.S. It's reestablishing trading partners. The U.S. is maybe redrawing their trading partners and seeing a greater emphasis on an area like Mexico. We see it a lot in the Asia region as well. And so those are things to monitor.
Okay, thank you so much for this. And I think we're down to our last question. Do you have any advice for investors who are interested in learning more about the global investing and incorporating it into their portfolios?
I'd say lean on ATRAM for all your financial needs. We are and happy to have ATRAM as a great partner of BlackRock, and we are happy to help you as well. I think when understanding and investing in equity markets, there is an incredible wealth of information that's out there. And having sort of trusted partners like ATRAM and BlackRock, now we are here to help you navigate through some of these challenges that we see on a day-to-day basis, and hopefully and strive to provide advice to help you navigate through that.
Okay, thank you so much for that, Brian. I agree on that as well. So if you have any questions for any market-related topics or investments, the ATRAM will always be there to help you answer your questions. So just don't be afraid to reach out. So before we end this Q&A, any final thoughts and insights that you would like to share with our audience, Brian?
So I think we covered a lot of ground. I'll be honest, I didn't think we were going to spend as much time as we did on talking about global markets, but I think that's the environment we're in. So no, I hope that this presentation has given you a great look at what the financial sector looks like over the rest of the year and even beyond into 2025. I think it's still a group that looks very compelling for a number of reasons I've highlighted. And so I really hope that you got some value out of the things we discussed today, and why I think that, you know, things look like we're in pretty good shape for to see, you know, continued returns across the financial sector and hopefully the equity markets more broadly.
Okay. Thank you so much again, Brian. We look forward to future opportunities and to learn from your expertise. Thank you.
Thanks very much for having me. Speak soon.
And now for a comprehensive overview of all the funds that we provide here in ATRAM, We invite you to explore our website at www.atram.com.ph. Feel free to visit for more detailed information. And also, did we mention that for as low as 1,000 pesos, you can already jumpstart your investment journey? Here's how you can invest in ATRAM funds.
Good day. If you are interested in investing with ATRAM, the leading independent asset and wealth management company in the Philippines, please visit our website, www.atram.com.ph. We have all the details you would need to know about our funds. If you would like to start investing, click Invest Now. For further assistance and account opening, you may email our client services team. If you have more questions, visit the website's Frequently Asked Questions page or ATRAM Academy page. We hope this helps. Thank you.
So apart from that, we also have ATRAM Prime. ATRAM Prime offers access to a diverse array of investment options. Those options empower you to tailor your portfolio according to your specific goals and risk tolerance. Committed to long-term growth, ATRAM Prime's expert fund managers utilize proven investment strategies, guiding you toward the creation of enduring wealth. For more detailed information, please refer to the video displayed on your screens. There you have it. If you want to learn more about ATRAM Prime, download the app below. So once again, kindly take a moment to visit and scan the QR code on your screen to access our official social media pages. You can catch a replay of today's session on ATRAM's YouTube channel, ATRAM Studio. And please don't forget, you can also check our website at www.atram.com.ph. For more comprehensive information on the markets, finance, investments, and all of the funds that we provide. Lastly, we would greatly appreciate if you could participate in the survey at the end of this webinar. Your thoughts on today's topics are very important to us. On behalf of everyone on ATRAM, thank you for attending today's session, and we extend our best wishes for continued health and safety to you and your loved ones. Have a wonderful day, and we'll see you in the next session.